Engineering. What is engineering all about? I often ask my students, do you know an engineer? And many of them say, no, I don't. In fact, they probably do know an engineer. It could be their parent, it could be an uncle or an aunt or a friend or the person next door. But they tend not to become highly prominent as other professions might be in accountancy or law or medicine, because a lot of what they do not in direct contact with the community, but in other areas as well and in within other organisations. But nevertheless, engineering is really all about people. It isn't just about technology. Engineering is about people, because all of the products, the services, the buildings, the infrastructure that engineers develop is designed for people to use. It's designed to protect our environment, and it's also about building wealth and economy for the company, for the state, and for the nation. So really, engineering is a vitally important activity that I'm pleased that you're all interested to find out a little bit more about those opportunities. Some people might say, why do I want to do engineering? And some of the starting salaries and progressions might be attractive to you. It certainly is a well-paid position and maybe right from the very start. You can get quite a high rate of pay, particularly if prepared to go into some of the more remote areas to get some of your initial experience. But I think that as an engineer, you'll find it's far more rewarding than just the financial rewards, because you get to use science, use technology, design new creative things that have never even been thought of yet. By the time you come out as an engineer, there are going to be brand new technologies, brand new opportunities, brand new ways of doing things. And we'll be expecting you to be the creative ones that come up with the ideas about how we can develop these new solutions to these new problems that are going to design new products, equipment and services that help people and our community, both locally and globally. So there's a lot of reasons for considering engineering. And so if you love mathematics and physics and chemistry and science generally, you like building things, constructing things, designing things, and testing things, then engineering may well be the career for you. There is an engineering shortage. There's something like 9,000 engineers produced by Australian universities each year, but the need for engineers is somewhere closer to 20,000 per year. So there are opportunities there. And through South Australia's University of South Australia, we aim to provide you with a degree that is going to fit you for work in engineering practice, to give you not only the knowledge, the scientific knowledge and the skills, but also the attitude and other attributes that are important for an engineer to be able to gain work in the engineering profession and to fit in with the engineering profession. And there are a number of ways in which we can do that that I'll outline a little bit later on. So certainly the employment opportunities are there, and while they do fluctuate from one year to the next and we get a little bit of a downturn or a little bit of an upturn, I think you'll find that overall the job prospects for engineers are very good, and we aim to help people to position themselves through other attributes that they will have that will make them seem very valuable to prospective employers of engineers. Some of those generic skills, the soft skills. It isn't just about the technology and having those skills. It's about having the good communication skills, the good interpersonal skills, good understanding of management and other areas which are vitally important for engineering. And if you have those skills as well, the employers are going to look to those, because they will assume you've got an engineering degree, they assume that you're technically competent, but they'll be interested in the other things that you do. So if you've got hobbies and interests, and other activities that you're involved in through sport, where you demonstrate leadership, working effectively with people, responsibilities that you have, they're also very important for becoming an engineer. The University of South Australia has invested heavily in engineering in recent years, some $73 million in some new buildings and technologies, and we're continuing to upgrade our facilities. So you'll be coming into an environment that is going to help you along that journey towards becoming a professional engineer. We have our first year engineering programs and our first year engineering facility, the Experience One studio, which gets people off to a flying start with that, working in small groups and undertaking interesting project work that I'll mention a little bit later on. and opportunities for gaining experiential learning by having a continual interaction with people from industry, and opportunities to go on site visits or to work within industry as part of your program. We also have some outstanding teachers present within the university. One of our teachers, Associate Professor Marfus Aziz, was the Prime Minister's 2009 University Teacher of the Year. And Julie Mills is another one who's won recent awards for the teaching. So we have a good team of people able to lead you through that as well. In terms of engineering at UniSA, we are based at Mawson Lakes, but it's a relatively short train trip to there from Adelaide, and there are other ways in which you can gain access to that area. If you haven't been out to Mawson Lakes for a while, go and have a drive around. Come and have a look at our facilities, and there'll be some opportunities later on through the Festival of Innovation to find out a little bit more about what it's like out there. It's certainly changed considerably. There's a nice little village and town atmosphere about the place with a lot of housing out there now. It's really a vibrant part of Adelaide, with research institutes and centres as an integral part of the University of South Australia's Mawson Lakes campus. I've touched on the industry links we have, but we also have other pathways that help people into the engineering programs through the university college and through the associate degree pathway if you're not a school leaver. So a number of opportunities available to you. If you wish to gain added skills to fit you for industry, we have a graduate certificate in professional engineering practice that can be undertaken in conjunction with an engineering degree in the last year or so of the program or immediately afterwards, which is about providing an internship that allows students to work in industry for a period of 15 weeks and hopefully lead on to more regular employment within the that organisation or that industry sector. And we're able to couple the Bachelor of Engineering degree with Master's programs as well. The sorts of qualities that we aim to develop within our engineering graduates, I've already touched upon those briefly. You do need to be inquisitive and curious and find out how things work and ask questions about how things work. If we don't ask questions, then A, we don't find out how they work, but we also fail to look at the really critical issues that make things work well. And in designing engineering solutions, there are many solutions that we could come up with, but which one is going to be the right solution for that particular context? If we asked you to design a new footbridge that went across the Torrens, there would be many different examples of how that would be done, but which would be the innovative, the creative ways of doing it in a way that's going to do something that is quite startling in both its architecture and its form, and also one that's functionally fit for the purpose. We expect engineers to be very analytical, and that's where the mathematical skills come into it. And we find that engineers may even choose to change their career partway through. They might have worked as an engineer for 10 or 20 years, but they realise, and other organisations realise, their skills are extraordinarily valuable. They've got this ability to analyse things and to synthesise solutions. And so we find them working as chairman of banks. So very diverse areas which engineering can prepare you and lead you on to later in life. It's something where attention to detail is important, but equally we want you to have the big picture of things. So when you look at something like the design of an aircraft, how many components are there in a modern aircraft? So a modern A380, how many components? Well, there's something like 4 million components within it, all part of the many, many systems that exist within that aircraft. How do you deal with a system that is so complex and so many components within it? You have to have that big view, first of all, to understand how an aeroplane works. From most of our point of view, it's about just getting you safely from one point to another, and it does that extremely well. But as an engineer, you want to know how these little bits of it all work and how they fit together. And understanding the complexity of that is one of the other things that we tend to focus on in terms of systems engineering. Some people like working on their own, but most engineers will work in teams, multidisciplinary teams. And we'll find that areas of engineering really blend. So my own area is in electrical, electronic and biomedical engineering, but I'd like to think that I've got a reasonably good understanding of mechanical engineering and civil engineering, so that if I need to talk with someone about a particular issue, I know which questions to ask them. If I see something, I think, that can't be right, tell me a little bit more about it. then you've got that ability to work across discipline areas as well. And also working with people from outside of the science and engineering area. You do need to be good at communication because you are working in teams, and if you have a fantastic idea, that isn't going to be sufficient if you can't make it happen through a team of other people that are working with you. So we'll have a focus on developing stronger communication skills as part of the program as well. The three principal areas in which we operate are civil engineering, mechanical and electrical and electronic engineering. Each of those has a number of specialisations within it, and you can choose those specialisations as you go to later years within the program. There are some new programs that we're introducing, including a Bachelor of Engineering in Mechatronic Engineering, which is a blend of electrical and electronic and mechanical engineering. There's also a new program in renewable energy systems available from 2013. All of the programs that we deliver here are accredited or would be accredited during the normal accreditation cycle by Engineers Australia. Engineers Australia is the professional body that is responsible for overseeing engineering within Australia. It has 100,000 members, and I was privileged to be its national president about 6 years ago. And it's been one of those great organisations that has a significant responsibility for the engineering profession generally, but in particular has responsibility for the accreditation of our engineering programs. And so with an accredited program, as you would do through UniSA, your degree will be recognised not only in Australia, but it will be recognised throughout the world in many of the major countries that would be practising engineering. So the UK, Ireland, the US, Canada, South Africa, Germany, Singapore, New Zealand, a whole range of countries, your qualification will be instantly recognised. It's also important to recognise that as an engineer, you are likely to have a global career as an engineer, that much of your work will involve going, well, having the opportunity to work overseas for a short period of time to gain additional experience or additional skills, or to work with Australian companies that build some of the key artefacts and icons that you see around the world. So, apart from the London Olympics that we've just had, if you cast your mind back to the Beijing Olympics and the Bird's Nest Stadium there, it was designed by an Australian engineer, Tristram Carfrae from Arup, one of our leading consulting engineering companies. An absolutely fantastic piece of engineering that did a splendid job, and everybody around the world recognises it for the features that it included. So many of you will have the opportunity to work internationally as well. Something like 5,000 of Australia's engineers work overseas currently. Coming back to our own programs and the pathways into those, that's a rather complicated slide, but all you have to do is to find the one on the left that applies to you. So if you're a school leaver, literally you simply stop at the first one, because your Year 12 studies are likely to be the way in which you are considered for entry into our programs. But if you're a more mature student or someone who's not had the opportunity to complete Year 12, there are other pathways that we're able to provide for you. And if you have questions about that, then talk with us afterwards or talk with our admissions people about a pathway that may be suited to you. Within our engineering programs, we have a number of courses, particularly in our first year, that are common across all areas of engineering. And I see this as one of our significant strengths. A course in sustainable engineering practice is one that we do in conjunction with an organisation called Engineers Without Borders. You might have heard of Doctors Without Borders or Medicine Sans Frontières. But this is a very similar organisation. There's a very strong group, mainly young engineers within Australia, that works on projects of humanitarian interest in developing countries. And so our students get the opportunity to participate in programmes that are linked to that. Again, it's a multidisciplinary project. You find yourself having to work not only with engineers across all discipline areas, but you'll be finding yourself working with people from human resources, from health sciences, from psychology, a whole range of professional areas that would become involved in that as well. And it really does demonstrate that engineering is about what I call the three P's. It's about people, it's about the planet, and it's about prosperity. All of those are embodied in that course, which sets you off and really lets you know what engineering is intended to be all about. Engineering design and innovation is starting to look at ways in which you put into practice some of your engineering knowledge. In first year, we don't expect you to be expert in that, but we expect you to have the ability to think, how could I solve this particular problem? Someone sets a problem and do some brainstorming, and next thing you know, a number of solutions pop up. Then you have to look at those, which of the ones are going to be most suited for this particular area. So I find that a particularly exciting thing, because engineering is about innovation, it is about entrepreneurship, it is about putting solutions into practice and seeing it happen, making it happen, being part of that solution generation process. Other courses like mathematics and computer techniques are really important for all areas of engineering. We can't escape that. We want to make sure that the designs that we do develop and build and implement are going to be safe for use, and the general public can have confidence in the quality of the engineering work that's undertaken within Australia. And I can assure you that we have some outstanding examples of that, and there's an engineering excellence program that's running, the Engineering Excellence Awards Night coming up in South Australia in a month's time, which will showcase some of those really great projects that are being undertaken. In terms of entry requirements for the program, we recognise that not everybody has the opportunity to study the specialist maths, and so we set as the prerequisite mathematical studies in year 12 with some assumed knowledge in physics. And you can look through these subsequent slides just to get an idea of the ATAR scores that might be required to get into a particular program. I'd suggest, though, that you look at what you really want to do first and put that down as your first priority. So if it's one of our engineering programs, if you're not sure about your ATAR score, still put it down. Put down your very first real wish first. And the ATAR score will take care of itself. If you're not eligible for that, hopefully you'll get one of your high, lower preferences. But there are other pathways, as I indicated, through the stat test, associate degree, foundation studies, and the SABET studies as well. Coming on to your first experience at university, this is the Experience One Studio. It's very much focused on students working together in small teams, looking at projects such as the sustainable engineering practice ones. So it's an area where they can explore and start to work independently as well as in teams. So it's a great learning environment that we've provided there. Coming to the particular discipline areas of engineering, my own areas in electrical and information engineering, and they are mainly concerned with generating energy and distributing energy and using energy. We're also about information, which is sensing what's happening in our environment. Lots of information, processing it, making some sense of it, storing it, manipulating it, and then using that information again to control things. You today will have used hundreds of systems that have been designed by engineers. Systems that take in information that you've provided, information from our environment, and then use it to control other things. So whether it's a motor vehicle, whether it's a communication device, whether it's some medical technology, whole range of things that engineers need to gather information, process that information, and then do useful things with it. So that's where electrical and electronic engineers come into their own. Sign at the bottom, again, to recognise that the purpose behind all of this is about developing systems that assist our community. The programs, I won't go into the details of things like the ATAR requirements, but that gives you an idea of the programs that we have available. A general one in electrical and electronic engineering. I particularly like that one because it has embedded within its four-year program an opportunity to undertake an internship within industry instead of one of your regular semesters of study. So you go out and work for a company for about 15 weeks. We prepare you for that, give you some of the smarts that you need to be able to gain that very first job as an engineer, and we work very closely with the companies to provide really first-class opportunities within that. But the other areas of specialisation that include mechatronic systems engineering, electronics communications, optical engineering, and the new one in renewable energy systems. I've touched on those, I'll skip over those. In terms of what they cover, mechatronics is starting to look at the blend between electrical and electronic and mechanical engineering, from looking at very small devices to some of the much larger devices, but probably focusing on the smaller, smarter devices that you see. So systems that are used within motor vehicles, systems that are used in medical technology, things like an artificial heart, how's it going to work? Then it's really a combination of some electrical, very smart electrical signal processing and some mechanical engineering that would form part of that. But whether it's your autofocus camera, something that dispenses products from a vending machine, all of which involve some form of mechatronics. The areas in which we can find application include defence, mining, automotive and the manufacturing areas. But the emphasis is on the smart technology and doing things that we can do really well within Australia using Australian people and Australian technologies. And we've got a fantastic new mechatronics lab where a lot of this fun can happen. And go down to the area where we've got the booth and you'll see some examples of that later on. But many areas there that you'd be familiar with but hadn't perhaps thought about opportunities where engineers could work, but that lists many of those areas, some of which are available in South Australia, some of which will give you the opportunity to travel elsewhere. In civil engineering, we focus on a lot of the infrastructure that's necessary for our community. So whether you're talking about transportation systems, water systems, that are useful for cities and towns, all of the buildings, all of those large pieces of infrastructure, the very visible ones, tend to be undertaken by civil engineers. And there's a continuing need for us to upgrade our infrastructure, and that's where civil engineers would have a significant role. Similar ATAR score, somewhere around 70 to 80, but as I said, follow your dream first and then work out what you might do once you get the offer. We have a number of streams. There's a basic stream in civil engineering, but then we have a number of specialisations, one in the structural engineering for those that want to get involved in the building area. Environmental management is more and more important to us to make sure that the things that we do design and build are constructed in ways that are sympathetic with our environment and preserve our environment for future generations. Project management involves making sure that projects are delivered on time and on budget and extremely well. And that's a whole new area in itself and a very, very important area. It's not about just getting the technology right, but working out how we're going to implement that technology and how we're going to get this project completed. Transportation's a very popular one within UniSA. We have a number of people that are very passionate about that area, and you would enjoy participating in that particular program. And then water resources is always a critical area for South Australia, whether we're talking about drinking water that's come from the Murray, whether it's come from a desalination plant, whether we're talking about water reuse, talking about sanitation. All of these are particularly important areas for our community, things that we generally take for granted, but it needs civil engineers to make those things happen and to happen well and for us to enjoy those facilities at the standard that we do. Employment prospects, like other areas of engineering, many of them now work within private organisations, some of the large consulting firms, some of which were originated in Adelaide, but others from other parts of Australia. And the majority of engineering work is probably now undertaken within those larger consulting companies. They've stretched across many disciplines now, not just in civil engineering, but across the whole spectrum of engineering. But we do need people within government who are well informed to be able to look at new projects and to be able to prepare the specifications for those. And we'll have people that work in very small to medium-sized enterprises that might only have half a dozen people within them. Maybe you've got an idea that you'd like to start your own business as an engineer. And there are many examples of South Australian companies that started in just that way that have gone on to be extremely successful, not only in South Australia, but internationally as well. And because our programs tend to prepare people for professional practice, then many of our graduates will in fact have a job lined up before they even finish their program. In mechanical engineering, a wide range of tasks that they get involved in the defence area, for example, if we look at the Australian Submarine Corporation, or ASC as it's now known, if we look at systems for air conditioning and air handling and general comfort of people, a lot of the work that's involved there requires mechanical engineering systems that are tucked away in a plant room somewhere in this building, but making this a nice, comfortable environment in which we live. So the engines, the turbines that need to be functional to do that need to be designed well and need to be able to operate for long periods of time with minimum amounts of maintenance. So the motor vehicles that you might drive are probably able to work much more reliably than you even imagine. They probably don't even need servicing as often as you might be encouraged to get them serviced, because advances in technology, both in the mechanical engineering side and things like materials and lubricants, which is part of mechanical engineering, mean that we're able to develop really sophisticated systems that work reliably for long periods of time. Entry requirements, again, very similar. Some double degrees available in this particular program with management and information technology. The programs that they offer, the fundamental mechanical engineering one, but also ones involving sustainable energy systems, the mechatronics linked in closely with the ones that we offer in electrical and electronic and using the same facilities, but also mechanical and advanced manufacturing. And some of you may be interested in our advanced materials program, which is a science degree program. I know I've already spoken with one or two people today about the options that exist in the materials area as well as in mechanical engineering. But some very useful techniques that you will develop and get heavily involved in the design as well as construction and testing. Areas in which they work, again, very similar to many of the others, with perhaps a few others added in, such as food processing, manufacturing, and pharmaceutical areas, as well as petrochemical and mining industries as well. So don't just think of mining engineering or the mining industry as requiring mining engineers. They require electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, and other disciplines of engineering as well, because it really is requiring a multidisciplinary approach. In terms of other ways that we can support you at UniSA, there are a number of scholarships available. For example, those who have done really well and get an ATAR greater than 97 will be awarded a scholarship with a total value of $5,000 if you study in one of our engineering programs and in a number of other selected programs that we offer as well. And there are also the High Achiever Equity Scholarships that provide opportunities for people that maybe have some special needs or come from special circumstances. You'll be able to talk with our scholarships people more about that as well. So engineering, to me, has been a very fulfilling career. I've enjoyed every moment that I've been involved with it. I've seen some fabulous examples of the work that Australian engineers are capable of doing. And I've been involved with students right from first year and seen the really exciting ideas that they have. They come along really, really fresh to it. And that inexperience, in fact, helps in some cases because they're not afraid to ask a question, which some people might say is a silly question, but in fact there are no silly questions to ask in engineering. If you don't ask the question, then that's the bad thing. So you must ask the questions. But they'll come up with the most fabulous ideas, and you think, gee, that's it. We could actually make that work. So it's an opportunity right from the early stages of your career to get involved in the design process, work as part of a team where some of these new exciting ideas and techniques that you work on within the courses that you undertake with us are going to be useful, as well as working in industry with people who've got more maturity and experience who can guide you along that pathway as well. Hopefully your engineering learning won't just finish with a university degree either. You'll go on and become, say, a chartered professional engineer, because you need to be able to continue to demonstrate that competence right throughout your career as well. But a very fulfilling career ahead of those who really have the aptitude and the interest in doing that. And we hope that we're able to provide you with an opportunity that really leads to a very successful career in engineering because of the way in which we focus on professional engineering practice as a significant part of our programs. So thank you all for coming along and listening today.